In the last video, I was talking about this phenomena of light-induced degradation, and it gives a lot of sleepless nights to manufacturers of amorphous silicon-based solar panels, especially because that's where this light-induced degradation is most severely experienced, and it can reduce the efficiency of these panels, significantly, to up to 30 or 40% in the very first few hours of operating the panel. So this is of course not a good thing. You want to avoid this light induced degradation. And then I was explaining in the last video how this light induced degradation occurs, and I gave you two of these models, this hydrogen bond switching model and the other model, which involves two of these hydrogen atoms, to explain how this light induced degradation occurs. And we saw that no matter which model you believe in, it's not universally accepted that which model is the one which is the true representation of this light-induced degradation. In fact, if you go to these thin film solar technology conferences, in the rump session, when people are the researchers have some wine in them, and there is at the evening of the conference, there's very heated debate which takes place, debating which of these two models is the true representation of this light-induced degradation. But nonetheless, no matter which model you put your money on, both of these models, they result in creation of these dangling bond states. Now, you might have already guessed that this creation of these dangling bond states is not a good thing. So what it does in terms of the solar cell is that I can represent the density of state in my solar cell. So for these amorphous silicon, I can essentially I have a conduction band state, and I have a conduction band tail. And so this is my conduction band, and this is my conduction band tail. And similarly, I have this valence band and this valence band tail. So this would be my valence band, and this would be my valence band tail. And this is my band gap, which for amorphous silicon is close to 1.78 electron volt. So now what these dangling bonds do is that they create these states within this forbidden region. So within this region between your valence band and conduction band, they create these states which lie right in the middle of your band gap. So let me represent that in a different color. Let me use blue. So they create they result in creation of these dangling bond states. And they lie right in the middle of these conduction band and valence band states. That makes them an excellent recombination center. So what happens as a result of these light-induced degradation is that you create a large density, or you increase the density of these dangling bond states. And that results in a lot of increased recombination in your cell. So now essentially your electrons and holes, which are produced, instead of getting collected, they can easily recombine. So they can make use of these dangling bond states, and they can use it as a recombination center to essentially recombine with this hole. So this is of course not a good thing. So you want to avoid this light induced degradation, and people try a variety of passivation mechanisms. So they do different treatments so that these bonds between the silicon and silicon, they become good, or these bonds, they are strong enough such that they're not broken when electron and hole pair recombine. So one might wonder, why does this light induced degradation does not happen in this way inside a crystalline silicon? The reason is that for crystalline silicon, these bonds are essentially, these bonds between these two silicon atoms, they are more stronger. So when an electron and hole pair recombine, it does not have sufficient energy to essentially break this bond. So that's why this light induced degradation, or this dangling bond creation, is not as prevalent in let's say crystalline silicon. Nonetheless, this people have tried to essentially quantify how these dangling bonds are created and how they evolve over time. So the researchers who work in this field, such as these people who publish this paper, they have very meticulously tried to measure the number of these dangling bonds as a function of the illumination time, or as a function of the time in which you keep the cell exposed to sunlight. And it clearly shows that as you keep the cell exposed to sunlight, you see an increase in the number of your dangling bonds. And this curve over here, it's plotting this data, let's see, in log scale. So what this linear slope in a log scale, it means that you have a power law dependence. So you have a power law dependence of this number of dangling bonds on the illumination time, and then you can measure the slope of this line, and that gives you the exponent, or that gives you the coefficient for that power law. And over here you see that this number of dangling bonds, it increases as a function of time with this cube root dependence on the illumination time. Similarly, you see over here that if you increase your illumination, or if increase the intensity of your light, you see that if you increase the intensity of the light, the number of these dangling bonds, as you increase the intensity from 50 to 100 to 200, again the number of dangling bonds is increasing. And in fact, if you measure this functional dependence on this illumination rate, or this generation rate, it again comes out to be this power law dependence with the dependence of g to the power of this generation rate to the power of 2/3. So these things, this power law dependence could be very easily derived by using these daunting set of equations. And in fact, there's nothing to be worried about. There's nothing to be afraid about this equation. Let me explain the different terms to you. So this, this first equation, what it's saying is that it's trying to relate the increase in the number of dangling bonds. So over here I have this derivative with respect to the dangling bond. So it's saying that the rate of increase of the dangling bond, it's essentially proportional to this forward process which creates this dangling bond. That is, this, it's proportional to the generation rate of your electron and hole. That of course makes sense. And there's a reverse process which essentially results in removal of these dangling bonds. That is, if you have dangling bonds present and you have your hydrogen atom present, this hydrogen can essentially passivate this dangling bond. So there's a reverse process, and so the net difference between these two, it gives me the increase in the number of my dangling bond. Similarly, I can write an equation which relates the increase in the number of my hydrogen atoms, and it would be again proportional to the number, it would be essentially equal to the number of dangling bond created, because every time you create a dangling bond, you create a hydrogen as well. And it would be proportional, there's a reverse process over here as well, and that is that if you have two of these hydrogen atoms present, they can essentially form a metastable state with each other. So the reverse process, which is proportional to the square of the concentration of these hydrogen atoms. So now I have these two differential equations. So I have the system of differential equations, and I'm sure how to solve a system of differential equation, but I must not assume how to solve a system of differential equation. In fact, it's a very difficult set of if you have forgotten solving differential equations, it might take you a while. So let me write the final formula. So let me write the final expression. That is, if you feel so inclined, you can solve these system of differential equation. But I want to just give you a feel of where this power law dependence comes from. So if you solve this system of equation, you'll get a formula for your number of dangling bond, and it's related to all these different coefficients over here. So it's related to this forward coefficient, it's related to the generation rate, it relates to the reverse coefficient. But the two most important things which stand out is this two-third power dependence on the generation rate or on the intensity of the light, and this cube root dependence on the time. So of course now I have some understanding of how these dangling bonds are generated, and as their density increases, my efficiency falls. So my efficiency, if I plot it as a function of time, so and let's say at t equal to 0, I had my maximum efficiency. Now as I keep on as I keep this panel exposed to light, the efficiency would degrade. In fact, initially let's assume I have no dangling bonds, so immediately when I start to create these dangling bonds, this efficiency will degrade. But after a while, you already have a lot of these dangling bonds, so addition of these further dangling bonds, all the damage has already been created. So the addition of these further dangling bonds, the efficiency will still keep on reducing, but the rate of this decrease of the efficiency would be quite low. And we want to measure, or at least when you want to buy these panels, you should essentially ask for this efficiency, which is measured at this point in time. And that is called as the stabilized efficiency. So organizations such as NREL and other organizations which do benchmarking of these cells. So for example, NREL has this chart, which I'm sure you're all familiar with, which plots this efficiency of champion cells for different technologies. And looking at this amorphous silicon, so let me look at the amorphous silicon. So amorphous silicon is over here. So you can see that for amorphous silicon, they always mention this term stabilized. So the efficiencies of these amorphous silicon cells, they have been reported after they have been exposed to light, and the efficiency, the degradation in the efficiency has stabilized, and that's where you should report the efficiency of these amorphous silicon cells. But many times you'll read these journal or conference paper, and they'll claim very high efficiencies for these amorphous silicon or these other thin film technologies. So you should always ask them, if you meet those people, you should ask them that, did you measure those efficiency the night you made those solar cells, or did you measure it after it was exposed to sunlight for quite some time? So you should always take those numbers with a grain of salt, and you should always look for these stabilized efficiencies.